I am privileged to welcome our keynote speaker. I think that the words from Dan said it well as to why we have invited him to present on coercive control. It was a very intentional thought process on the planning committee. We wanted to be able to go on into this subject in depth with the expert. We have in the state of Washington a long history of understanding that domestic violence is a pattern of assaultive and coercive behaviors that includes more than just physical violence. It includes more things than just criminal acts. And it is critical that we, in developing our responses and prevention efforts and intervention efforts, that we revisit the definition of domestic violence, and particularly through the lens of coercive control. His credentials, I was first introduced to him, his work back in the early 70s, and he was then known as the husband of Dr. Ann Flitcraft, who is a pioneer in responding to domestic violence and health issues. He joined with her. He was a founder of a first shelter here in the United States. All of you know about his work with coercive control and his widely acclaimed book on coercive control. Without ado, I will simply welcome him to the stage, Dr. Evan Stark.
Attorney Soderberg said when he looks out at this large crowd, he feels hope. I feel fear. I was asked to remind you, I said when I came in to someone in the back, you won't be able to see me, I'm very short. She hesitated for a minute and then she said, but it's near the coffee. So I just want to say to the folks in the back, Tracy asked me to mention this, that there are plenty of seats closer here. I know this never works with students either, so. A few sort of introductory comments, observations that came to mind when the marvelous record of Judge Dubuque was being rehearsed by Ann Ganley, whom I actually have known of for many years, but only first met last night. One thought, obviously, was that we should also, when we build our public monuments, think about those who have devoted their lives, like Judge Dubuque, to those who can't often speak in their own voices. And also think about, when we're building public monuments, those women themselves who have survived the horrors of lives that most of us could not, and I certainly could not, have known. Let me start, and I want to encourage you, as I'm doing this, to bring into the room the women you work with. I'm speaking slowly, by the way, because I just came from Portugal, where I had to give a lecture in an audience where there was no translation, which no one understood. So I thought if I spoke slowly, it would help, but apparently, so I'll speed up as I realize where I am. But I'm encouraging you to bring into the room your own clients, your own sisters and mothers and neighbors and friends, because I won't have time this morning, at least, maybe in some of the workshops, to really go through a lot of the specific case material. And I'd like you to have in your mind somebody very specific as we're talking. And this is one of my clients, a woman named Terry Traficanda. And it was a warm summer afternoon in July, and her husband, Nick, chased her and their nine-month-old baby, who was in her arms, across the lawn, where she took refuge in a neighbor's trailer home. Nick walked around the trailer a few times, looked in the window, then he burst through the door and told her to get the F home. And when Terry didn't move, he grabbed the baby, ran out of the trailer, jumped in his pickup truck, drove out of the driveway at a high rate of speed, at which point she called 911. Now, we don't know exactly what she said, but there was testimony at the murder trial at which apparently she said, send the police, my husband has kidnapped a baby. And the dispatch operator, after having dispatched two officers to the scene, continued to question Terry on the phone. And that went on for a few minutes. And as they were talking, Nick, who apparently had just driven around the block, drove back in the driveway, jumped out of the truck, ran back into their house with the baby, and Terry changed what she was saying on the phone. Call off the police. Call off the police, she told the dispatch operator. At which point, of course, contrary to everything we teach police, the order was remanded, and Terry ran back into the house, and 3 hours later was shot dead. Now, at his murder trial, Nick explained that they were watching a hunting movie on the hunting channel. You know, they have all these golf channel and whatever, shopping channels, and I don't know how you can, I've never been able to figure out how you can shop in a store if you're watching the shopping channel, but I guess there's a way of. So he was watching a hunting movie on, they were watching a hunting movie on TV, and Terry had asked her, him to show her how it was done. And so he was demonstrating how it was done when the shotgun went off accidentally. And unfortunately for Nick, went off several times accidentally. Well, it seems absurd, but it's interesting that at his murder trial, the judge chose to lecture Terry in absentia for, quote, staying with the brute so long. I hope when our county prosecutor was reminding you of the Ron Rice case, that the image that came to your mind was not the NFL commissioner, but the prosecutor in Atlantic County, New Jersey, who not only had arrested her in the domestic violence scene, but had released him with no charges, dropping all charges, after presumably having seen the same evidence that we saw on TV. And of course, that's part of what we're saying. But in any case, I was hired by Terry's sister in a wrongful death suit. And you know, the point of a wrongful death suit is to show that something the police could have done or should have done that night would have made a difference in the outcome. And the lawyer for the town, I'm sorry this is so complicated, but that's the way much of our work is. The lawyer for the town was questioning me. He's an old friend. He had been a police officer and had helped write the state domestic violence manual. And he said, Doctor, what would you have had the police do differently that night? I reminded him that several weeks earlier, the police had been to the house on a domestic violence call, and that they had arrested Nick and taken him down to jail. And shortly after they removed him, Terry had called again and asked that a weapon be removed. And they had returned to the house, and one of the neighbors, actually the husband of the woman whose trailer she had taken refuge in, came over and said, look, I'll take care of the gun. I'll hold the gun until he cools off. And the officer, not sure what his jurisdiction was to take the weapon, had given the neighbor, and of course, the gun. And this, of course, was the gun that he used. And then I told the lawyer what I had found as the result of my investigation and believed was an impressive array of findings. I described the fact that there was only one cold piece of pizza in the refrigerator, that Terry had not been allowed to go to work or leave the house for the week, that there were bruises all over her legs and arms, suggesting that abuse was not just current, but ongoing. There was no toilet paper in the downstairs bathroom, and she hadn't been allowed to use the upstairs bathroom. And she had not been allowed to touch the baby except to feed. Now, we know this. I learned this because she was able to make one phone call to her parents during this week. And when I finished describing, again, what I thought was an impressive array of events, the lawyer for the town repeated the question again, "Doctor, what would you have had us do differently?" And what he was trying to get me to think about, and what I want to start a conversation here today, at the first conference, so far as I know, to be held in the United States on coercive control, what I want to get you to think about is that until Nick Trafficante shot his wife, Terry, he had not committed a serious crime in the state of Connecticut, and probably not in almost any of our other states. That all of the things that created a scenario that made Terry a virtual hostage in her home were completely invisible, even though they were easily in plain sight once you looked to see them. And I was reminded again about this during the O.J. Simpson trial. I was one of the stringer experts put on hold by Marsha Clark. And as you know, we had 9 arrests of O.J. We had the letters acknowledging what had happened. We know that he had hired someone to follow Nicole Brown. He himself was stalking her. There were all kinds of admissions and descriptions of his abuse. And yet, Marsha Clark, the prosecutor, decided not to use the domestic violence evidence because she believed, and I believe rightly believed, that the jury would not take it seriously. And if you remember, they interviewed the jurors, and one juror said if they wanted to talk about the domestic violence evidence, they should have gone down the hall to domestic violence court. And another juror said, what did domestic violence have to do with it anyway? So something that was absolutely transparent to any one of us who worked in the domestic violence field was completely invisible to the folks in that case. So now I'm going to learn how to make this move. I'll come back to Terry as we're talking. But I wanted to introduce her because it was out of that case that I began to think way back to 1972 when we first hid a woman and her 9-year-old child in our house before we had opened the shelter in our town of New Haven, Connecticut. And I had asked her, as I'd learned to do in working with rape victims, to talk about the violence. And she had gone on about all of these other things, saying violence wasn't the worst part. And I would remind her, because we knew how difficult it was for rape victims to talk about the violence, talk about the violence. And it was only gradually and over the last decades that I and many, many other advocates and policymakers and lawmakers throughout the world have come to recognize that there is an incredible gap between what women like Terry Trafficante and her 9-year-old son are experiencing and what the law and medicine and all of the institutions of our society, including our shelters, define as the domestic violence crime. So our first job, and not just here this morning, obviously, but throughout the next 2 days, is to close the gap between the realities of abuse that those we work with and those we love are experiencing and our response. And that will require us to look beyond violence. My job is to provoke thought and to challenge you. And part of the way I'm going to challenge you to is insist that domestic violence is neither domestic nor is it about violence. And then I'm going to try to describe what now all over Europe is understood to be the dynamics and consequences of partner abuse against women, of violence against women. I use the term coercive control. England has adopted this now in its official definition. Spain, the Netherlands, Denmark, Turkey, and a number of other countries have adopted it. We're going to talk later today about the Istanbul Convention, which was signed by 40 European countries, in which the same themes of coercive control are adopted by all of the European countries and committed to criminalizing this behavior. And hopefully, as a result of 2 days of talking about coercive control, we'll begin to think about what that implies for us revisioning and reforming how we interact with those clients, those friends, and others who are victims of coercive control. Nothing I'm going to say is meant in any way to diminish the significance of the revolution that you and we have made. I sometimes think when Judge Dubuque and Anne Ganley and myself get up that we need a lot more younger people to take. I couldn't come. I was invited, I think it was last year or 2 years ago, to this symposium. I was in intensive care. You know, we're getting on in years. Not Anne and not Marie Fortune or others, but some of us are getting on in years. So we, you know, rather than put us up as old relics, we'd really like. But I can remember coming across the country with my wife Anne in 1972 or 3, and stopping off to see Sharon Vaughan, an old friend in St. Paul, Minnesota. And everyone was very mysterious about where Sharon was. And finally, we tracked her down to a not yet gentrified section of St. Paul. And I remember knocking on the door and the door opening and a woman looking out and seeing me and slamming the door in my face. I don't remember which of the children it was. There was a time in my life at that point when children seemed to come out like popping corn. And my wife's idea about child rearing is that there's this little bald man, me, who takes care of the children. She never took a minute. She did it, delivered, and did a lot of the work. I don't want to get in trouble here, but she never took a week off of work, and I was proud of that because she made more money than I do, and as Anne suggested, she's a lot smarter than I am, too, so I was a lucky man, and she's a younger woman. But anyway, I had one of the children, and I remember sort of pinching him a little bit. Child welfare people, close your ears. Just enough so that he cried a little bit. Not a lot. And this time when I knocked on the door opened, and this time they didn't just see bald man, but bald man with crying child. So they let me in long enough to say, I'm a friend of Sharon's and would like to see Sharon. I had no idea where I was. And I can't now, looking back, recreate the scene. But I can tell you that there were women everywhere. There was a group of women going out the back door, coming back. There was a large African-American woman holding an Ojibwe woman in her arms who was sobbing on her shoulder. There was this group of women meeting in another room. And then in a room that had obviously been an office, there was a woman on the telephone, and there was another woman talking to her as if she wasn't on the telephone. And all of this chaos was reverberated by children running up and down the stairs yelling. The place was riotous. And then Sharon came down looking like Katharine Hepburn in the Philadelphia story, and in that delightful Minnesota accent that was made famous in the movie Fargo, you remember, she told us this was a battered woman's shelter, and told us the story about how she and her friends had been answering the phone as volunteers for Ramsey County Legal Services, and how one after another, women needed housing, and so they had rented an office, and they had brought women into the office, but the kids knocked over the shelves, and everything was disarray, and so quickly they were evicted, and so one of the women had put up her home as collateral, and they had then gotten this house. And how within a few months they had run out of money and their lease was going to be called in. And they had not told anybody where they were because this was a secret place. And yet, as if a great wind had brought it, she told us how money began to arrive, checks under the door, little notes pasted to the things in the mailbox. I wish you had been there for me when I needed you. And within a few weeks, they raised the $35,000 they needed to pay off the mortgage. And it was right after that and our return to New Haven that, as Ann said, we started taking women into our homes and then opened one of the first shelters in the United States. And a year later, we were privileged to go to London, to Chiswick House, the first shelter that was founded in this wave of shelters. There were shelters back in 1860 in the United States, but in this wave of shelters, and again, you know, we knocked on the door, and Erin Pitsey, the woman who founded it, very, very large woman, blots out the sun, opened the door, looked down, let us in. There were 90 women and children there that night with a Jamaican woman in the lead, and we had a little portable bus, and we had some portable toilets and some wallpaper, and we took the bus and went to another section of London, and we seized an old railroad hotel, and within 24 hours, we had opened up another refuge for women. And I start with those stories because I could give you the statistics on how many men we arrested last year, how many protection orders we gave out. We sheltered almost 4.5 million women and children in the United States, close to 500 million worldwide. But at the bottom of all of this, I want you to keep in your mind the image from St. Paul and the image from Chiswick House of women doing for themselves. Because there was no idea in our minds that these were women who, quote, needed services, that these were women who were problem women. Yes, they were women with problems, but we also understood that the best way to solve those problems was through the collective creation of a women's space, which was what the shelter was designed to be. And I start with that because that ultimately was the origin of the women's movement that brings all of us here today, even if it's not as visible as it was then, and we have the Violence Against Women Act anniversary was mentioned. And that was a difficult day for me, the Violence Against Women Act. Difficult for two reasons. One was that I had to kiss Newt Gingrich. Because we had to embrace the people, and Henry Hyde, who was even worse, you know, the bane of abortion, but we had to make with them nice. He probably felt the same way, by the way, so I don't want to, and particularly Henry Hyde is a big, tall guy, had to lean down and hug me. And the other reason was because Bill Clinton wanted the Violence Against Women Act because he didn't want to deal with abortion. I mean, people should recognize the reality of that act. And he needed women's votes desperately. And that bill was part of the Crime Control Act, which was not, in many of its elements, shall we say, a progressive piece of legislation. And we have been making compromises like this throughout our history and will continue to do them. So the Violence Against Women Act, yes, it's a celebration, but it's also a reminder of how far we need to go, not just because there's so much domestic violence, but also because we need to have an uncompromising commitment to these issues. Now, during the Violence Against Women celebration of the 20th anniversary, Vice President Biden rightly celebrated the rapid decline in homicide that has been brought about by our interventions and the rapid decline in serious violence against women. And I'm just, I don't know if you can't see this, those of you who have sat in the back preferred coffee to sitting close, but I want to tell you something about this. Yes, there has been a dramatic drop in partner homicides over the last 40 years. And there's absolutely no question that that drop is a direct result of arrest policies and prosecution policies and shelter and other interventions that we have. No question about it. But if you look at this table, what do you see? You see that the major beneficiaries of the decline in partner homicides are men, not women. Men, not women. And the decline in partner homicide of African-American women is almost 80%. If you notice, in 1974, when we opened the first shelters, African-American women and men in abusive relationships were equally likely to take each other's lives. Today, there's an 80% fewer chance, less chance, that in that encounter, an African-American male will die. That's a greater decline in the health problem than we've seen in almost any other problem ever in the history. It's an unbelievable decline. And the killing of African-American women has declined slightly, about 1% a year, much less than the overall decline in homicide during this period. But, and this is the critical point, the killing of Caucasian women, the largest group in our society, has not changed more than 1% since we opened the first shelters. An achievement. Yes, of course we men want to stay alive. I was at a meeting of the Great Panthers recently where they were talking about all the things the old women were going to do after we were gone. And finally, I raised my hand. I mean, I know my wife's going to have sex with another man. I mean, she's a younger woman, you know, and I know I'm not. But I raised my hand. I said, couldn't we be talking about keeping us around a little longer? So I sympathize. I'm glad we've saved the lives of men. And understand why this is so. And it is so for the same reason Terry Traficanda died. It is so because women tend to kill male partners, abusive partners, when they feel themselves or their children threatened. Not necessarily in self-defense, but by giving them shelter, by giving them protection orders, by arresting the man, we have given them a respite. And so that respite has protected the men from the harm that they would otherwise inflict. But because that respite is so temporary, because those offenders continue to have access to their partners, they are not safe from men who tend to kill women when they feel they are losing control, when the woman is separating. Now, I told you that there's been a 60% decline in severe violence against women, and there has. And again, that has saved thousands of women's lives, unquestionably. But during that same period, there has been such an increase in low-level violence against women that overall levels of violence against women have not changed and are appreciably the same today as they were, not only when we signed the Violence Against Women's Act, but when we opened the doors of the first shelters in the United States. Now, you say, isn't it better to replace serious violence with low-level violence? Isn't it better not to be stabbed and simply to be slapped and punched? Although we saw, I mean, the nice thing about the elevator film, even though I felt like Mrs. Rice felt that it was a humiliating film to show, if I was her, I would not want that film shown, right? And she was right to say that this was embarrassing and humiliating. Imagine if she had been raped. Would we have shown that film on CNN? The point of that film was that it was evidence in a trial. But of course, a trial that went nowhere. But I mean, that's an aside. Maybe a lot of people may not agree with me about that. But the thing is that in this period, low-level violence has increased. And what I'm going to try to convince you of in the next few minutes is that the most insidious and devastating and common form of violence against women, coercive control, is characterized not by severe violence, but by an infrastructure comprised of frequent, routine, low-level violence whose cumulative effect is as devastating or more devastating than any other crime in our society, including kidnapping and hostage taking. And again, the gap between the reality and the way we conceive of it. This is just another, this is a table from some of our research in England. I could show you the same tables from the United States. But basically, what it shows is that for every 100 incidents of domestic violence reported to the police, approximately 3.6 result in charges and convictions. 3 out of 100. And so the dismissal of the charges against Ron Rice were not an aberration. In New Jersey, and I know this from personal experience, 95% of domestic violence cases are essentially heard in traffic court. And I know it because I worked in New Jersey and I was in traffic court more than I should have been. In Connecticut, my home state, between 95 and 98% of domestic violence cases are nollied or dismissed. In England, the same study, if you have been reported to the police 50 times, or 100 times, or 150 times, you are no more likely to be convicted and sentenced at the 150th incident than at the first. And each incident leads to an independent risk assessment. So the same man who can be high risk on Wednesday, 2 weeks later, can be considered low risk. And I could show you this data on rape, and you would see exactly the same evidence for partner rape. About 3 out of every 100 partner rapes, and I'll present some figures on this, lead to conviction and any kind of punishment. So what I would say is, yes, we have criminalized domestic violence, but in doing so, we have turned it into a second-class misdemeanor for which virtually no one goes to jail. I'm not talking about your felony courts here, which and the prosecutors are wonderful and strong. I'm talking about the vast, vast majority of cases. And why is that? And I believe one reason that is because we use a violence model still. We still think that violence against women is a form of assault. And so, like all assaults, we treat each incident as a separate event. And then we judge those events by the probability that injury might result, by their severity. And we think, primarily still think, that domestic violence takes place primarily in intimate relationships. And we still rely heavily on local interventions, prevention interventions, that target individual victims or individual perpetrators. And I'm going to challenge this very quickly. First, I want to just show you, to remind you, that violence is an experience throughout women's lifetime. And this table is designed to show you that at two extremes, we don't have adequate services. One is that 38% of the injuries to young women, 16 to 18, and 18% of the injuries to older women are domestic violence injuries, and these two populations largely fall between the cracks. Either they're too old for child protective services and too young for adult protective services, or they don't, because they're taking medication or because they have other limits or just do not see our contemporary services as relevant to them, fall between the cracks. So these are major needs I just wanted to focus. I also wanted to remind you, and I'll do this also quickly, that most violence in our society is not violence against women. When people say they want to stop violence against men, and they use that and say, don't women hit men too? And I'm going to show you that it is true, that probably when it comes to simple assault, women hit men as much as men hit women, no question about it. 100 studies now show that. But what you can see is that, I don't know if you can see in the back, but what you can see is that the vast majority of violence in our society is against men, not women. And it is committed by men, not women. And it is long past time that we believed, that we continue to operate under the belief that you can stop men's violence against women, teach them respect for women when they don't have respect for each other and for themselves. And that we broaden our community efforts so that we're addressing violence and its roots in masculinity, not just saying, all right, you can't hit women, but it's okay to beat up your buddy. Now, that's challenging. That's my job. But if we're going to stop men from exerting power and control, we can't parse out that power and control by saying they can use it here, but they can't use it there. The first thing I want to show you is that there's no such thing as a single episode of domestic violence. No such thing. They showed you this terrible assault by Ron Rice. I will absolutely guarantee you 99%. He wasn't even in my classes at Rutgers. I didn't have him because I didn't teach undergraduates. But I can guarantee you 100% that there were multiple assaults in that relationship. And here we have data from the CDC that shows women reporting, look at just more than 50 times. This is population data, not data from women in shelters. Population data from the general population showing how many women are reporting being choked or kicked or hit with a fist or object or beaten or slapped. I just put those in. I could have put many in. 11 to 50 times and more than 50 times. More than 50 times. A third of women are telling us they're being assaulted every day. Every day. So I want to remind you, we use the euphemism choked, right? Oh, they were choked. And you ask a woman, were you choked? Yes, I was choked. And mostly they're choked multiple times, as you saw from that earlier thing. Look at that, choked 11 to 50 times. But the reality is choking is what happens when you eat an apple core and it goes down the wrong way and you're gasping for air. These women are being strangled. And strangling is a felony. And Washington has one of the most progressive laws on strangulation. But we have yet to use it widely in ordinary domestic violence, even though it's out there. So, I mean, I'm just, again, giving you some sense of the gap between reality. The second thing about frequency is that it's completely gendered. When we talk about frequency, we're talking about men's violence against women, not women's violence against men. And I'll leave you with that. I'm not going to belabor that because we have to move. The second point I want to make that dispels the violence model is that severity of injury is a good indication of the severity of abuse. Nothing could be further from the truth. Here are three sites, the emergency room, the military, the police, where you expect to see the most severe assaults, and you can see that 95 to 98% of all the domestic violence reported in those arenas is, excuse the word, trivial from a medical or a criminal justice standpoint. Slaps, shoving, pushing, kicking, hitting, punching, pulling hair, nothing we want done to us. But as well, not necessarily something that when a police officer or an emergency room physician looks at the body, they're going to automatically recognize this is severe abuse. And yet you can also see that if we wait for severe injury before we get involved, we're going to miss 95 to 98% of domestic violence. I'll just tell you this and move on. 54% of the men we're arresting for domestic violence are not married to or physically sharing a domicile with the persons they're assaulting. The risk of domestic violence is highest among women who are single, separated, and divorced. In fact, the only population that sees a reduction in domestic violence are women who are widowed, which in my forensic practice is not an insight that is lost on my clients. Excuse me, prosecutors. But the reality is domestic violence is ongoing. The average domestic violence lasts between 5.5 and 7.2 years. So now let's just stick with the violence and let's just figure this out. 5.5 to 7.2 years times 33% of the women are being assaulted every day. Plus, we saw all of the women who are more than 50 times being strangled or being kicked. And so what we're talking about, typically, these aren't exaggerated, unusual cases. Typically, what we're talking about are women who experienced at minimum dozens, often hundreds, and sometimes thousands of assaults, all of which fall below the radar of a system that gears its attention to severe injurious violence. Do you get my point? Yet, to women like Terry Trafficante, it is the cumulative effect of this ongoing frequent violence, not the severity of the violence, but the frequency and the duration that determines its severity. We also know that domestic violence is associated with disproportionate rates of a whole range of health problems. And I don't have time to go into each of these. Maybe in the workshops, if people have questions, we can talk about them. But at first, we thought that the reason battered women had all of these health problems, and most don't, but enough do, that they're significant as causes of these problems, that the reason battered women had these health problems was because this was multiple problem women who also got abused in domestic violence relationships. In our research with Dr. Flitcraft, who Ann said pulled me along into research, I was home taking care of the kids. Yes, good for me. I know. It's so funny, when Ann goes shopping, no one notices that the first few years when they would see me every day at the shopping, people would treat me like I was doing some kind of great act, you know. So it's. I tell you, if you're a man, I mean, there's two things I want to tell you for the men who came here today. It's courageous, but for the men who came, if you look around you, you see why working in the battered women's movement is a great thing to do. Secondly, you get a lot of personal rewards when you do this stuff, right? You start treating people with respect and dignity in the community, and you'll be surprised who's going to start rewarding you and treating you well. So I get a lot of, wherever I go, speaking abroad, maybe it's my age, women hug me and they... So it's a very good thing, guys, to stay in this area, I just want to tell you. But what this research shows is that up until the time women are abused, they have no more problems, no more depression, no more alcoholism, no more drug abuse, no more suicide attempts than women who are not abused. It is only afterwards, in the context of ongoing abuse, when they're medicating the stress, that you begin to see these disproportionate rates. Now, what this tells us, if we want to deal with domestic violence, we have to be in alcohol, we have to be in drugs, we have to be in mental health. And moreover, if we're in mental health, and you know that 45% of female alcoholism is directly attributable to abuse, you need to be dealing with abuse. Wherever you are in the health or mental health system, this window has to be opened whenever a woman comes in to look at it. We're going to talk about this mostly tomorrow, but I just wanted to put out there, because it's amazing to me, isn't it to you, that even though domestic violence is the leading context in which children are abused, there is probably not one program, even in this marvelous state of Washington, which deals with men as the abusers of children. Probably not one. Wherever you look at the research, parents are a euphemism for moms. In New York City, we're going to talk about the Nicholson lawsuit tomorrow and maybe a little bit later this morning, where we forced New York City to stop removing children from moms simply because they were victims of domestic violence. In New York City, until our lawsuit, all cases were listed under the mother's name, even if she was dead. Even if she was dead. So a problem that accounts for anywhere between 45% and 50% of harms to children in abusive relationships is virtually invisible. And I will argue, even against your dependency court and against your child welfare system, still largely invisible, at least in its dimensions to the child welfare system. So women and children's reality, as opposed to the model, is that abuse is ongoing, that rape and DV fall on a continuum, and that the effect we're looking at is cumulative. If a woman comes into our office and her fear level is up here, but all we see in front of us as a police officer, a medical officer, a social worker, is a slap or a push, the problem is not that she's hysterical and crazy. The problem is that we need to drop a plumb line into the history of her experience. This is why virtually every country in Europe has made historical abuse a crime, something which is still light years away in the United States. Virtually every country in Europe, starting with Turkey, has made severely enhanced penalties for ongoing physical violence, something that is only occasionally the case in the United States. Every country in Europe has linked domestic violence and sexual coercion and stalking in a legal framework, something the United States is just beginning to think about how to do it. And of course, when we look at, and I have to skip ahead, but when we look at domestic violence through the prism of the violence model, abuse is trivialized. No one goes to jail. It's not because police aren't doing their job. They are. In Britain, in some areas of Northumberland, we're now arresting 90% of offenders in domestic violence cases. That's amazing. And still no one is going to jail. Because if I look at the incident, and if 98% or 95 and 98% of the incidents are trivial, no one is going to be charged. You get it? And so these men come again and again and again. England is spending more money now on domestic violence than on its defense budget. And yet it has not reduced domestic violence one percentage point. Why? Because you cannot do it when you trivialize domestic violence. And what happens, in fact, and you'll recognize this from your own experience, when we don't see the chronic nature, the cumulative nature of domestic violence, what happens is, as women continue and persist in bringing their problems to our attention, we begin to withdraw. Those women become well known. If I'm a police officer, I know when I go to that scene, I'm going to see he's going to be drunk, she's going to be bleeding. You know, maybe I'll pull him out of the house. Maybe he'll go downtown like Nick Trafficanda, but he'll come back and he'll be madder than anything. Right? That's what the lawyer for the town wanted me to acknowledge. Sure, they could have arrested Nick that night. Sure, if the dispatch operator had let them go, they could have arrested Nick. But just as he had the last time, as soon as he got out, he would implement his regime of control about which nothing would be done or could be done. Better not to press charges. Oh, she didn't press charges. Really, she didn't press charges. What would have happened if she had pressed charges? Would you have removed him from the community? Just like violating or not, or letting a man in the house or not, or marrying him or not. I mean, it's a very persuasive marriage proposal if somebody knocks me unconscious, spits at me, pulls me out of the elevator, and then gets away with it. That's a very effective marriage proposal. Now, you may not think so, oh, that's terrible. How could she go back and marry him? Well, what's the alternative? The alternative is not to marry him and still be abused and maybe even worse. I mean, the constraint in terms of her decision-making are enormous. So when we look at domestic violence through individual incidents, we not only trivialize the crime, but we create a situation where, as abuse escalates, services pull further and further away. I was going to show you this stuff about rape, but I'm not. I'll just summarize it by saying that the vast majority of rapes are committed by partners or acquaintances. About 3% of all rapes are committed by strangers. Do you know that? The vast majority of rapes are committed by partners or strangers. And since when abusers commit rape, they commit it multiple times, the vast majority of rapes reported to the police. And in fact, the vast majority of cases of rape taken by the police are cases by acquaintances and strangers. But again, the conviction rates are around 3%. And even when the men are convicted, they're not convicted of the rape, they plead to domestic violence. And I can show you all kinds of data on that. Why is that? It's because these women have been multiply raped. It's because they don't want to press charges because the rapist is still living in the house with them. It's because they have confounding psychological problems and won't make good witnesses. And this is why in Europe, but not in the United States, we are bundling domestic violence and rape in ways that allow prosecutors and police to see the connections in these things. And it's sad in part because I want to tell you this, domestic violence is easy to prevent. It can be prevented. In our medical research, we found that almost 90 out of every 100 cases that comes to us in the hospital, and I would say somewhere between 85 and 87 cases that come to the police, are long-standing cases. That is, there are cases in which, had there been early effective intervention, there would have been no more domestic violence. About 10 cases out of every 100 are new cases that have not come to the attention of anyone before. Imagine if we could reduce these, the burden on our community, the health burden, the police burden, the economic burden, the social burden, 80 to 90% by effective early intervention, we could manage the 10% of cases. Our courts wouldn't be flooded. We wouldn't have to create special courts or special prosecutors in order to ration the demands that are placed on us. So now let's, in the few minutes we have left, and I'm sorry, but again, we'll continue some of it later. I have another? I thought I had only 5 seconds. I have 10, oh, 10:45, wow, I don't have to, I'm gonna go back to my Portugal pace. Obrigado. You understand? Obrigado. TK and I were in Taiwan last year, was it? And my nickname in Taiwan was Yeye, which means grandfather. That's what my grandson calls me. He's Chinese American. He says Yeye. So now we'll go back, given all this time, to the woman who came to us and said violence wasn't the worst part. And let's see what she was talking about. Right now, this is where my thinking is, and I think some of the other researchers in the field think the same. I hope you can hold it. If you went to Catholic school, you can, but I don't know how to. I know it's a long time to be sitting. Excuse me, I'm in Seattle. I know I'm not in New York. We're trying to understand what we're looking at, because we know that not all domestic violence is the same. And for some of this, we have the Fathers' Rights and Men's Movement to thank, because they have challenged us. They said, women hit men, don't they? And many women said, oh no, they only do it in self-defense. Well, that's not very, my clientele are mostly women who kill abusive partners. And so I know that women use violence, and that it's a very common thing for women to use violence. So what are the contexts? Well, first, let's talk about fights. Well, let's not talk about them. Let's recognize that a very common context for abuse is fights. Look, my daughter, now my son, he's transgendered. When my son was still my daughter, you can't laugh in Oregon, but in the United States, in the East Coast, you can still laugh at that. When Eli was still Rachel, in his high school, if you didn't fight when another girl called you out, you ate your lunch in the bathroom. And it didn't matter whether you won or lost the fight. It didn't matter. What was important was that you stood up and that you confront. It was a good conflict resolution strategy, fighting was. And it avoided a lot of bullying, at least in that school. I'm not advocating fighting. I'm not saying violence is a good thing. I'm just saying it's a common thing. And a lot of the violence between men and women falls out of our purview because it is in this arena of fighting, even where women learn, as they will tell you on the street, sometimes you have to take a beating. Because if women in this world, maybe you haven't learned this or you fight in your own ways, want to be treated as equals in almost any context, including the boardroom or the courtroom, they have to fight. And in many relationships, the only resources they have to use to fight are physical. So I'm not talking about fighting, but a lot of violence can be classified that way. The second thing we're looking at, we'll call partner assault. And it's very much like what you think of when you think of domestic violence. The only difference between domestic violence and partner assault is that domestic violence is almost always repeated. So while our laws on domestic violence are okay, they still could do a lot better by enhancing penalties for repeat abuse. Domestic violence tends to be largely, but not exclusively, conflict-related. It is committed by women, probably as frequently, if not as severely, as men. By frequently, I don't mean they commit frequent domestic violence. I mean as many women do it. Obviously, as I showed you before, men's violence is much more frequent. Men's violence is much more injurious. But the reality is that many millions of women use physical means, and many of them use those physical means, I will tell you, as a feminist, for the same motives of power and control that men use physical means against women. And they are often jealous, like men. There's no point in this movement, at this stage in our development, or your work, to idealize the women whom we're working with. Because if you do, you'll be very disappointed by the clients. You're not doing it because these are good women who happen to be hit. You're doing it because you understand that a certain kind of oppression and domination is not the way free people behave in a just, equal society. The issue in Ron Rice's case to me, as it should be for every police officer who goes into a domestic violence situation, and certainly is in our shelter movement, is not what decision she makes or doesn't make about staying in the relationship. Our job is to see that whatever decision she does make, she makes without the fear of being treated with violence, by being treated as unequal. That's our only job, to make sure that the context in which her choices are made is a safe one and a free one. We say in the battered women's movement, you may not understand this if you haven't worked in it, that we know we've done a good job when a woman leaves our office and we know she's going to do the wrong thing, and we let her leave. And we let her leave. How can I say that? If you're in child welfare, you could never take that position, obviously. We say that because our job is empowerment, not moral correctness, right? I'll give you an example. A woman comes into our shelter about 6 months ago in Newark. She hasn't been allowed to cut her hair in 2.5 years. Her hair is filled with lice. Her braids are stuck to her face almost. She has a terrible odor coming from her head. And right after dinner, every evening, she runs upstairs and hides in her room with her three children. And then after she'd been in shelter and word had gotten out for a few days, the women called her downstairs. And they had what they called a celebration of hair cutting. And with each strand that they cut, as they surrounded her and cheered, and she was crying like a baby, they represented her right to make mistakes without, you see what I'm saying? So wrong choices, right choices, that's not our job. Our job is safe choices and free choices for all the people in our community. Partner assault, we think, accounts for somewhere between 20, probably more likely, to 40% of the women who are using our services. And I could say more about it, but we'll set it aside for now. Because I want now to focus on what the dynamic that affects the vast majority of women that seek our help. 60 to 80% of the women that we see in shelter, that seek protection orders, that call the police, that come to the emergency room with problems of abuse, are not experiencing fights or partner assaults, they're experiencing coercive control. And I'm not putting my definition of coercive control. For that, you can buy my book, and it'll be on sale, just coincidentally, at the reception tonight. And those of you, there's a lot more of you than there are books, I'm sure, and I can't sign that many books, but you can always get it on Amazon. Or I just want to give a promotion. And the money is not going to charity, with all due respect to the judge. But this is the definition, not my definition, but the definition that was adopted in 2011 and went into force in August 1st of this year at Istanbul. And it is a definition accepted by all of the countries in Europe as the framework for their lawmaking and for their prevention efforts and for their prosecution and for their shelter programs and for their public education. And notice they start by defining it as a violation of human rights. because I'm going to repeat this mantra, and if it's the only thing you take from me, that would be very fine. Domestic violence is not about what men do to women. Coercive control is about what men keep women from doing for themselves. It is, and that is what makes it a violation of their human rights to speak, their human rights to walk, their human rights to work, their human rights to keep their money, their human rights to care for their children. All of the petty violations that we're going to talk about now come together as violations of the most fundamental sort and are recognized as such. The African nations signed the first treaty against coercive control. The South American countries signed a similar treaty, but the Istanbul Convention is the first that carries the mandate of law and national plans to implement these violations. And they talk about it as a form of discrimination. Why? Because it is so intimately and inextricably linked to inequality. And that's why I say you can't understand and you certainly cannot prevent violence against women at the level of individual relationships without at the same time addressing inequality at the level of the community. Because without one, you can't resolve the other. Any more than you can take a drug addict or an alcoholic and send them back into a community which celebrates drinking and drugging and expect that your drug treatment is going to have much effect. So it's gender-based violence, and it's discrimination. And we're not talking about a feminist statement here. We're talking about conservative governments in Germany and in Italy and in other parts of the world adopting this framework as the UN has adopted it. And we're talking not just about physical, but also economic harm and psychological harm. And it is the last phrase in this definition that I want to call special attention to, because I wish I had thought of it. Everything else, I've worked with them. They've taken a lot of language from me. I've taken some language from them. But there is nothing more important than that last phrase in understanding coercive control. And there is nothing more invisible in plain sight than that last phrase. And there is nothing more devastating when you talk to women than that last phrase. The arbitrary deprivations of liberty. Arbitrary in the sense that there's no rhyme or reason except the exertion of dominance and control and harm. So what is coercive control? Well, we've talked a little bit already about the physical dimensions of it, the fact that it's frequent and routine. Wasn't it here that they did that research, Anne, that showed that men's heart rate actually went down during abusive episodes? Understand that for many men, abuse is like going to the bathroom. It's automatic. It happens every night. They don't get all excited and tense. Some do. But it's just their routine. I'll give you an example. One of my clients is an Emmy Award-winning journalist. She was the anchor woman on Fox News. And she married the guy who does the morning news on ABC, and they moved out to his Greenwich estate, where her main job, because he had made her quit a job, was to take care of his two grown, worthless children. And he had a rule in the house that she had to answer the phone by the third ring, or else. And he would come home from work, and he would listen to the phone to see if anyone he didn't recognize had called and call back the number. And then he would get himself more and more agitated, begin to throw dishes around, food around, begin to yell and curse. She would write down in her diary, the only evidence I had, by the way, Mort goes crazy. And then he would lock her in the room for the duration. As far as I know, as far as she told me, he never physically abused her. Not once. And yet, when the phone rang in my office while I was interviewing her, the hives that began at her fingertips had covered her neck and face before the third ring. In this Emmy Award-winning journalist, the level of fear that was excited by the control was such that he didn't have to beat her to make her terrified and feel the fear of arbitrary deprivations of liberty. So the physical violence is routine, and the physical violence is frequent and has to be judged that way. And in about 20% of cases, there is no physical violence. We have a wonderful population survey from Finland that shows that women who report the highest levels of symptoms associated with being battered are a population of older women, women in their late 50s, early 60s, who have not been physically abused for an average of 10 years, and yet have more symptoms of all of the problems we associate with abuse than a population of younger women who are still being beaten 2 and 3 times a week. Remember, domestic violence, physical violence, is, for the most part, rational, instrumental behavior. If you don't need to use it, the FBI, in a case not too long ago, the Domenici case, was furious at Mrs. Domenici, who had come forward a number of times to complain about her boyfriend. And he kidnapped her. And the FBI came in on the case, and they interviewed her, and she said he never used any force during the kidnapping. And the FBI was furious. And when I interviewed them after her boyfriend killed her, they told me that, look, you know, she was so ambivalent about pressing charges. I said, well, John, I mean, this was the FBI agent. I had gone to high school with him. I said, John, look, you know, I said, didn't she complain to the police all these other times? Didn't she tell you about the rape that she had brought before the judge, where the judge had released him on a minor bail, even though the prosecutor had asked for $10,000 bond? The judge was censured for that. And the FBI agent sort of realized that. But what he couldn't get was that when he kidnapped her, he didn't have to use violence, because the regime of control that he had established. Do you think Ron Rice has to knock his wife out now every time he wants to have dinner ready at 5 o'clock? All he has to do is raise his eyebrows and remind her with a look, right? That's all he has to do. Oh, I'll pick up the phone and call the police and the prosecutor, okay? I don't mean to be looking at you, but I'll call the prosecutor. What's the prosecutor going to do? I remember when Mike Tyson, when Robin Givens' mom called our office in New Jersey and was screaming because Mike had broken up all the furniture in the house, and I called the prosecutor right next door to Atlantic City, in Monmouth County, and I screamed at the prosecutor, well, you gotta arrest this guy. It's his house. It's his house. What was he, 22 years of age? His house, he can do what he wants with it. Even though Robin and Tyson were terrified. The sexual violence, I'll come back to this, but the sexual violence also runs the gamut. And again, we cannot trivialize this. Just because it's only a domestic, you can't say that when there's rape and sexual coercion. But understand that rape is just the tip of the sexual coercion that goes on in abusive relationships. At the other end of the spectrum is what I call rape as routine. When Dila got married, right after their wedding, she laughed on the phone with his uncle. And then he slapped her in the face, broke one of her teeth. And then he wanted to have sex. Now, if you're a man, you understand that men don't necessarily make connections between not getting along and not having sex. For us, there's a kind of disconnect. A lot of women feel if you have a big fight, they don't necessarily want to make love 5 minutes later. But anyway, Dila wasn't feeling well. Maybe I have to tell that story in Portuguese, say that to get a laugh, I don't know. But Dila wasn't feeling too well, so she demurred. So he tied his hand behind her back. Oh, I have that there. And he had his way with her. And she never said no again. I cannot tell you the number of my clients who have told me similar stories, that they have sex year after year after year, and in their mind, maybe 1, 2, 3 moments where it was always the or else, right? Either you do it or else. And that is sexual coercion as much as physical rape, when they're having sex. And you don't get it unless you take that history. So I want to come back, and I know TK is going to, and the lead expert in the world, not just here, is going to talk to you about stalking. And I have learned so much from her work. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about the second dimension, which is intimidation and stalking, except to remind you because you know all about the major threats, you know what they look like, threats with guns, threats with weapons, threats to the children. I don't have to enumerate that list for you. But what you also have to be aware of are the invisible threats that may even seem like love. In my community, there was a game called the texting game, where the batterer texted in a number to the victim, and she had to guess the significance. For example, he would text in the number of the police department, and she had to guess what would happen to me if I called the police. Or he would text in the number of a department store, and she had to guess what shirt he wanted for his birthday. Now, this may sound like it's trivial, but it underlines two points, is that coercive control is so powerful and so much more powerful than physical violence because it crosses social space. The next time you wonder, how come when she's at work, she doesn't just call the police and run away? Coercive control is at the workplace. This is a poster we're developing in England, the new type of poster that's replacing the posters that are just focused on violence. The kind of stalking that takes place in relationships, is in many ways more insidious and is not against the law, and we don't deal with it, than stalking that takes place after a separation. For this woman, going to the bathroom was like going to Paris, because it was one of the few times he could get away from her, and he would follow her. And he would close that space. I talk about women having, every woman I've ever worked with having what I call safety zones. Some place in their life which you have to help them find if you're counseling, a relationship, a piece of clothes, a diary, something, some place they can go, a room, a relationship to a child, even another boyfriend like she had in the burning bed case, where she was going out with a police officer at the community college. Some place you can go in your mind or with your body where you can consider your options and breathe the air of a free person. And for every safety zone that women create, the batterer goes on search and destroy missions, opening her drawers, going through her pocketbook, listening to the phone calls, tracking her with GPS devices and all of the mechanisms that TK will talk about in order to choke her off, in order to close off those spaces so that the only dependence, the only sense of reality she gets is from him. But perhaps the most insidious form of intimidation, and I started to talk about that, are the silent forms of intimidation, I said that feel like love. And I'll just give you one quick example of this. One of my clients is a softball pitcher. She pitches for a team called the Stratford Queens. And they have a rule in the house that she won't make him jealous. You can know who the judge is and jury is in that case. She won't make him jealous. And when she strikes out 4 to 5 people during a game and he's there and watching every moment of her play, he begins to get that old feeling that she's paying too much attention to someone else and not enough to me, and people are paying too much attention to her and not to me. That feeling of emptiness that every batterer recognizes. And so he goes out into the field and he comes up to her and he says, "Darling, you're cold. Here's your sweatshirt." And her team members think, what a wonderful guy. You know, my boyfriend's off in a bar getting drunk somewhere, and you know, this guy really cares about whether she's cold or not, right? I can see by the look in your face that you understand the message of covering up. But even if he never touches her that night, the message is clear. And the effectiveness of the message is not just the threat that she feels, but the isolation that that message imposes. And I'm not going to spend much time talking about isolation, but you should be aware of it. Because every abusive relationship hinges on the offender's capacity to isolate women, not just like with the beeper game at work, but from work, from school, at school, right? From her family, from neighbors, from church, from every place. And again, you can be isolated at some place by phone calls that go on constantly, by the line of cars that's outside the telephone company at lunchtime. It doesn't mean I don't let you go to work. It means that work becomes another place of imprisonment where you enact, go through the motions of being alone and free, but the reality is you're a corpse on furlough, that you're being essentially controlled and constrained just as you would be if he were right there, except that you feel much more foolish because the lines of authority and control are invisible. In the most extreme cases of isolation, women experience the same sort of Stockholm syndrome that you see in sexually abused children, where they come to believe that the only man who can protect them, the football player, the only man who can protect them is the man who is hurting them, and that their only test of reality is placating and pleasing him, and everything else is extraneous. I can't tell you the number of offenders who themselves have called child welfare, who themselves have called the police to show her that no one will help them. Because once that sense of isolation is aggravated, or the woman begins to accumulate labels in the hospital that send the same message he's sending, right? Or medication that send the same message he's sending, that she's crazy, right? That she's the one, then she's done for. So fortunately, we have now data from the CDC again that shows conclusively the overlap between these three coercive behaviors: physical abuse, stalking, and sexual violence. I won't read this to you, but this is in the general population, by the way. This is not in our shelters. And what you see, if you look at this, is that 9% of the women in the general population report that they've been physically and sexually assaulted. Stalking, rape, and violence, 13% of the women in the general population. That's millions of women. So when I talk about the coercive aspect of coercive control, don't tell me I'm talking about just something psychological. I'm talking about the combination of the structural isolation and control with this high level of coercion. Another human right that has been recognized all over Europe and that's violated regularly in coercive control is the right to respect and dignity. Again, in every abusive relationship, whether it's through burning with cigarettes or tattooing or simply finding out what it is in your life that is most meaningful to you and taking that away for you. One woman last week, when I was giving a talk, got up and told me this story after she was divorced. She was totally into gardening. She loved gardening. Maybe this won't make any sense to you. Totally into gardening. No, I don't mean gardening will make sense, but the story. She's totally into gardening. And she said 1 week after the divorce, she came home and there were flowers planted all over her yard. Again, does it mean something? Is that a sign of love? Or is he choking off the space of self-expression? All right, maybe this. I'll tell you one story, maybe illustrate it better. My client is an African-American woman whose father's a minister. She's from New Jersey. She's moved into Connecticut. She's a nurse. Oh, I only have 5 minutes. I have to go quickly. So I won't tell you the story, except to tell you it was bad. You would love it. I want to now, because this is really the essence of this, finish by focusing on the control dimensions. We have said since the domestic violence movement began that domestic violence was about power and control. What we now know is that control is also the major means by which men dominate women in abusive relationships. And they do that by exploitation, deprivation, and most importantly, I think, by regulation. Exploitation, deprivation, 54% of the men we're arresting in Massachusetts are themselves telling us they have taken their partner's money. Now remember, if that was in a community, that would be robbery and theft. In a family, it is not a crime. And that they have taken other vital things, and they are locking them in the house and doing other things to them. But what is interesting about regulation and what finally marks, I only have 10:30, what do you have? 10 minutes, all right, 10 minutes. I grow, time grows. Benjamin Franklin said that. what makes coercive control a gendered crime, among other things, is not just that it happens to women, but that the focus of regulation, and I describe in my book a number of cases which you can buy tonight at the reception, that coercive control focuses its regulation on the micromanagement of those roles that women perform by default simply because they're women. How they make love, how they mother, how they clean, how they cook, how they dress. And the more trivial the rule in the house, you vacuum till you can see the lines, you cook a dish that fits exactly into the refrigerator, you wash the shower curtain, all of these real examples, and I could give hundreds more. The more trivial the rule, the more degraded they feel when they have to obey the rule. The more degraded they feel, the more lack of dignity they experience. This will just give you, this again is CDC population data. And I've juxtaposed that to data in the service system. Look at that. Look at that. That's your population. Monitoring their time, making them account for all of their time. 25% of all women in the population who identify themselves as abused are having their time monitored. In our shelter population, in the police population, in the court population, the number is closer to 85%. Off the radar, invisible in plain sight. Threatening suicide, no socializing with friends. 14%, 15% are telling us they're not allowed to leave the house. Again, a crime if committed in public, 79% of the, or 62% of the women in our services are telling us this. Invisible in plain sight. And you could go on. So again, this regulatory behavior in conjunction with the exploitation, the deprivation, the intimidation, the humiliation, the isolation, and the violence, sexual and physical, is what comprises coercive control. So just to end with a few just sort of things to think about. We're now learning that control predicts fatality and serious injury better than violence. And why does it? Because the major harm of violence against women when it takes the form of coercive control is not physical injury, it's entrapment. And because when what makes a battered woman is not being hit upside the head, what makes a battered woman is the socially constructed inability for that woman to survive, resist, or escape when that abuse occurs. And the reason she cannot survive, resist, or escape effectively, and therefore can be seriously injured and killed, is because of the coercive control. I don't have time, but I would explain all of the resistances that women mount to this. Even when a woman attempts suicide, she is resisting the coercive control. There is no end to resistance, even if it has to go underground. One of my clients, after letting her husband back in the house because he promised to get rid of his girlfriend. She was Catholic. He would never bother her again. As soon as she let him back in the house, he started following around the house with a video camera to show how crazy she was. She took a near-lethal dose of pills in front of the children and was hospitalized, changes the locks, won't let the children visit her, and so forth and so on. But fortunately, somebody in the hospital understood that her suicide attempt was what I call control in the context of no control. In other words, she couldn't control whether she was abused, whether she was hit, whether she was humiliated. What she could do by taking the pills was control how she was hurt, and when she was hurt, and where she was hurt. That is a point of strength, not a point of weakness, because by opening up the constraining context and making choices work, we do a great deal. So, just end with an understanding that I know in America we don't tend to talk about human rights. We tend to talk about constitutional rights. But until we put violence against women that takes the form of coercive control into the context of liberty rights, look, just ask yourself, how would our community react if there was a population of 35.5 million men who were being told how to dress, told how to clean, not being allowed to wear their hair long, having their money taken away from them, having their time monitored, being sexually abused, being degraded physically. How would our community react if this was happening to men? How would a man react? How would our court react if a man took the law into his own hands when he suffered that kind of degradation? So until we grant women full status as persons, it is impossible for us to understand the depth and extent of the violations that occur. Because if women are considered lower than men to start, then forcing them to enact rituals which deprive them of the most fundamental liberties of speech and movement is as of nothing, because they only have this much to fall. It's something akin to regulating how fast slaves pick cotton, as opposed to slavery itself. So clearly, the dialogue about human rights and about coercive control begins with ascribing to women the same status we would ascribe to men, and asking then, what are these harms like? And what does a community in which these harms are so widespread have to do in order to take on this? The first thing we need to do is give it a name, just as we did domestic violence 40 years ago. Today, for my kids, violence is the litmus test for the integrity of a relationship. We need to make it over the next 40 years so that domination and control in relationships is the litmus test of the integrity of relationships. And we need to start that in our schools and in our communities, but we cannot forget the soldier victims whose survival is so important. I mean, I do believe that our heroines and your heroines and some of our heroes should be getting statues and recognitions that they deserve. And I know that we had a man run for president who was a prisoner of war, and they have a big statue of him we saw in Arizona because he had survived the horrors of being in a prisoner of war camp. Vice President Cheney. Not our Vice President. He didn't never got elected, right? Not Cheney, that's right. What's his name? McCain. McCain. Somehow those images fuse in my mind. McCain. But if we're going to build statues for people like McCain, and this is really where I began, I think we really have to start building statues for the women who are surviving what I'm describing. And we really have to let them know that we don't see them solely as victims, but really akin to Rosa Parks when she was too tired, right, to move to the back of the bus. The women that are coming forward and asking our help are merely the tip of the iceberg of what's happening in their families and their networks. And instead of hiding them away in shelters only, and shelters are absolutely vital to their survival, we need to follow them down into the community of indigenous women, where not only safety, but also freedom becomes our priority, and begin to have a conversation that not only involves the many of you who've come this morning, but also everybody else in our community about what we mean by being a civic society of justice and equality and fairness. And to what extent does that compel us to act as one, to create norms, so that when a man goes through a batterer's program, or is arrested in New Jersey, or is told that what he's doing is wrong, and he turns around, the next man is not just going to wink at him, but everybody in the community is going to, as one, hold out their arms in welcome, and at the same time, constrain him to acknowledge that that welcome is contingent upon the equality and justice and decency that women have a right to respect and expect. Okay, well, I'm sorry. Thank you.